For Android, there are two languages that we can use here, Java and Kotlin. Now, Java has been around for a very, very, very long while. Many of us started programming with Java. I started programming with Java. It's easy and sometimes hard, but not hard than C++. C++ was hard. Hey guys, so this week I almost did not film this episode. Like, I was going through so many different things. I've been trying to set up the business properly, and I find myself working overtime and worrying about so many different things. It's been hectic. But my mother watches these videos, so it's been fun making them, especially because of her. She's always asking me, like, is there a new one to view next week? And I'm like, yeah, there'll be. So I have to make them, right? At least, even if she's the only one watching, I'm okay with that. So first things first, let's review last week. Now, last week we looked at product design, right? How we take our product from inception, the whole idea, right? To talking with our various users that were actually using the product and getting feedback from them on how they will actually feel about different things and different features in the product, categorizing their responses so that we will know, okay, are this the typical response from 30-year-olds or the typical response from 40-year-olds or 70-year-olds, depending on who is using your product. Then we move on to the topic of using our user personas. That is categorizing all these personalities into different sets of personas that we can actually view as one person, right? So what I give this category of people a particular name for a particular person, and then use it as a personal set to identify that person. Then we can now reason what this person wants, what are their motives and goals using the product, what do they want in this different section, what are the pain points that they experience while using the product. Then we moved on to the product flow section, right? How we actually identify how our product will flow, different pages that the product will have, from sign up to onboarding to dashboard or whatever part of the app that you might actually need, right? So based on that flow, based on the experience that we have identified for them, we create a flow. So that's where we stopped last week. This week we're going to be looking at the actual art of building the product. What actually goes into building our product, the actual technologies that are involved in putting the whole thing together and making it the kind of wonderful thing, our next Facebook, if you will. But let's identify the goals of this video, right? First things first, we are going to look at the product development lifecycle. What actually happens in the act of building the product? Then we'll look at different sections that the products we have, the front end, back end, and the deployment of the product. Then we'll also look at team management, how we delegate tasks, deadlines, and the various ideas that might come up from your team while you work on the product. This is an even crucial part of the product development process, right? The people that they are working with, the various engineers, developers, designers, they will actually give you ideas of things that you can actually input or implement in the on the process, and this may actually change different things about your application, make them better or make them worse, who knows. But they will give you ideas, and you need to know how to bounce ideas off them too, because nobody builds a product in isolation. So it's time to look at the product development lifecycle. The product development lifecycle, we were taught about that in school if you did computer science, right? It's a series of steps which you take to develop a product from beginning to the end. And usually there are steps of iterations where you go back again and again and again, depending on the feedback from your customers or from your users or from whoever the end user of the product is. But we're not going to focus on that. We're going to focus on the actual art of building the product, right? What actually goes into the development of the product, the art of coding it, if you will. Now, there are two major parts to developing your product, right? Especially an online product. There's the front end and there's the back end. Now, the front end is where all of your UI activities actually happen. Everything with relation to our designs and the general look and feel that the users interact with, that is what happens on the front end. Now, what happens on the front end dictates what will happen on the back end. You see, the front end is what actually feeds information to the back end. So the back end is actually serving the front end. Now, there are usually two different developers for these different activities that will happen on the front end and the back end. Now, the front end is where we use HTML, CSS, and JavaScript to usually develop videos on the web. But these days, there are several other technologies that many people are using to do these things. Now, there are different layers of abstraction to this, but just generally, it's just HTML, CSS, and JavaScript these days. Now, there are so many other libraries that we can actually use on this part, because many people don't go for the whole writing of HTML directly, or CSS directly, or JavaScript directly. These days, we have frameworks which makes it much easier to actually build front ends in terms of components, different sections of the front end as individual parts combined together. So there are libraries like React, Angular, Vue, Ember, Meteor, so many others. They are there for front end development. Right? Now on the back end, this is where we actually use tools like PHP, Node, and Golang, with so many others. There are several tools to use on the back end. In the description below, I'll point to a GitHub repository where all of these things were defined and explained. Web development 2020. Now, with relation to all of this, the front end serves the back end, and on the front end, you can also add mobile development, because usually most mobile apps are interacting with the backend API. So in my own definition, really, I consider most mobile apps to just be front ends to a backend. Now on mobile, there are two different sections which we develop for. There is Android and there's iOS. Most mobile devices today, they are either Android or iOS. Now for Android, there are two languages that we can use here, Java and Kotlin. Now Java has been around for a very, very, very long while. Many of us started programming with Java. I started programming with Java. It's easy and sometimes hard, but not harder than C++. C++ was hard. Now, Kotlin came out for Android development. It was built for that reason. It's very, very easy to understand, and when I checked it out, it was really, really cool to use. On the iOS side of things, we have Objective-C, and we have Swift. Now, Swift was created for iOS development. Objective-C was around for a while before Apple decided to start using Objective-C in developing their iOS apps. But Swift was created for iOS development. Now, both Java, Kotlin, and Swift are all used for native mobile development. That is, they are meant to develop on the native language. So the rain just started. Sorry for you. So I do consider all of these contents, both the mobile development section and the web development section. They are both contents to me. Now on the back end, there are a ton of tools we can use to develop our backend. Usually almost anything can actually be a tool to develop on the backend. There's Node, there's PHP, there's Golang, there's Haskell. People still do that. I think Facebook did that. And so many others. Now many people are going to be fighting over each other. Like if you go on Twitter, you see so many lab battles about backends. What to use, what not to use. Same thing with frontends. React and Angular will be fighting for things. If you want to know more about tools that you can use in developing your frontends or your backend of the application, and know which kind of developer you are going to hire, there are tons of resources all over the internet. I will leave some in the description below so you can get a feel of it. Now let's look at team management. Developing software is not easy at all. Like most of the times, you have to hire a team to work with. Someone who knows content, someone who knows backend, and someone who is really good at deploying your applications. So there are a ton of things that you have to do. You have to learn how to manage a team. And usually there are different tools on the internet that you can use to manage your projects and share tasks among your teammates. There's Notion. I use Notion a lot for both personal management and team stuffs. Then there's Clubhouse. Clubhouse is another good option. It's dedicated for software development. There's Trello, which everybody has been using since God knows when. And there's Asana and Jira, right? These guys are under the Atlassian family, so I can call them brothers and sisters of Trello. Yeah. So, product development goes deep into so many different aspects. You're actually going to start writing code. It's very, very complicated, and I can't cover all of it in one video. So, with respect to developing your team or managing your team, you also have to take into cognizance deadlines and ideas. Deadlines will come and go. There are times in which you won't actually meet deadline, and there are different developers who take different amount of time to actually do different things, right? So you have to take all of this into cognizance. You have to be patient. A lot of times you have to be really, really patient. Now, many CEOs and founders, they are not patient with their developers while they work on these projects. They usually expect things to be done at a fraction of the second. Being a developer, I understand what they may be going through, because in order to do something at a certain level and at a certain level of what will I call it, of quality, you need to actually give it a certain amount of time and dedication, right? So in as much as you are making sure that they are doing the job perfectly well, they are focusing on the job, you also have to make sure that you give them ample time to accomplish those things. Now, don't give them much time than they would need, obviously, because then they will take up enough time to fill in the time that they will need. But you have to actually give them enough time. This is why you have to actually understand what goes into a feature, what goes into the product. You have to also create time to fix bugs, because bugs will appear, they must appear. It's a given. Next, we are going to look at deployment, how we will actually deploy our apps online. So after developing the product from start to finish and you are sure that it's ready for use, you have to deploy the app to the internet. Usually there are several services that will actually help you host your application. One of the most popular ones is AWS, Amazon Web Services, and they host a ton of applications for so many different companies and startups. That is actually the reason why Jeff Bezos is thinking rich, because everybody is hosting their stuffs on his platform. Think about that. Now, so aside AWS, there are other services like Google Cloud Service. They are also really, really good. And then there are other little services like the VPS systems, DigitalOcean, Volta, and so many other VPS platforms that will give you virtual servers to host your platforms. So that brings us to the end of this episode, right? I know it was very, very short. I just touched on all of the basic ideas going on everything. But in our coming videos, we'll be going into all of this one by one and different ways by which you can manage your process in building your applications, taking you through my own process, right? So it will serve as a kind of example of what I'm talking about. Now, what do we do today? We went through the process of developing front ends, back ends, mobile applications, and then the general idea about managing a team, what it will actually take to manage your team and put everything there together. Later on, I'll be making longer videos on different ideas like this, but for next week, we are going to be looking at focus, like how do you actually maintain focus while working on your projects, because usually there are so many ideas that come to one's mind when you're working on their projects. With that in mind, I complete this video by saying subscribe, like, and comment. Let me hear what you have to say about these things. So, thank you.